Welcome to our service today. Today is Communion Sunday, and I would just invite you, if you haven't already, to take a second and prepare the elements that you will need for communion today. So if you need to push pause right now and go and do that, and then come back and join in with the service, feel free to do so. Remember, you don't need to have grape juice and unleavened bread on hand in order to participate today. We understand and we know that we in our homes don't always have those supplies, so simply take whatever you have on hand and prepare that at this point, and we will participate when the time comes. Hear this call to worship as we prepare our hearts to worship the Lord today. Our hearts are ready, O Lord. Our hearts are ready. We will sing and make melody. We will awaken the dawn. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. We will sing praises to you among the nations, for your steadfast love is great above the heavens, and your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Let's pray. You have called us to be members of one body, O Lord. Join us with those who in all times and places have praised your name. Join us with one another, although we meet in separate spaces, so that with one heart and mind, we may show the unity of your church and bring honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
God, give us new every morning. Mercy is daily bread. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus we pray. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us with your hand. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus we pray. I will sing, sing. song I will sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song to the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaim mercy of your name on earth as it is in heaven. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaim the mercy of your name on earth as it is in heaven.
Matthew 11:16-30. How should I describe this generation? These people are like a group of children playing in the public square. They complain to their friends, "We played wedding songs, and you weren't happy. So we played funeral songs, but you weren't sad." And for John the Baptist didn't drink wine, and he often fasted. And you say, "He's demon-possessed." And I, the Son of Man, feast and drink, and you say, "He's a glutton and a drunk, and a friend of the worst sort of sinners." But wisdom is shown to be right by what results from it. Then Jesus prayed his prayer. O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you for hiding the truth from those who think themselves so wise and clever, for revealing it to the childlike. Yes, Father, it pleased you to do it this way. My Father has given me authority over everything. No one really knows the Son except the Father. And no one really knows the Father except the Son and those whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Then Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are worrying and who are weary and carrying heavy burdens. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke fits perfectly, and the burden I give you is light."
Of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come near. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your all. has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are, come as you are, come as you are, come as you are.
Today we enjoy coming together to the table that Jesus invites us to come to. And so as we come to the table today, even though we are worshiping again in our separate spaces in our homes, we come together as part of the body of Christ. And so today we celebrate being a part of that body. And we remember that even though we are not physically together, in order to experience this holy sacrament, as we experience this in our homes, the presence of the Holy Spirit, the presence of the risen Lord is with us as we partake of the bread and the cup, emblems of his shed blood and broken body. And I pray that this would be a means of grace for you as you participate in this meal this morning. I want to remind you that you don't have to be a member of our church or any church to come to the table today. We have an open table in the Church of the Nazarene, and we simply ask that as you come to the table that Jesus invites us to come to, that you come remembering what these emblems represent, his broken body and shed blood. Today, as we enter into this time of communion, I invite you to follow along on your screen. I will read the light prints in the slides that you see in front of you, and you respond by reading the bold print in your home. And I invite you to join in as we begin right now. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. By whom you made the world and all things living and beautiful, we bless you for your continual love and care for every creature. We praise you for forming us in your image and calling us to be your people. Above all, we thank you for sending Jesus to deliver us from the way of sin and death by the obedience of his life, by his suffering upon the cross, and by his resurrection from the dead. We praise you that he now reigns with you in glory and ever lives to pray for us. Therefore, with the whole company of saints in heaven and on earth, we worship and glorify you, God most holy, and we sing with joy, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to God that our Savior, Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this memorial of his sacrifice until his coming again. For on the night of his arrest, he took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this as a memorial of me. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this as a memorial of me." This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given as a sacrifice for sin. Today we eat this with a sense of thanksgiving and gratitude and joy. Let's eat this together this morning. This cup represents the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we remember, as we have thought about over these last number of weeks in our worship services, that because of Jesus' shed blood, because of his sacrifice, and because of what he does now in the throne room of heaven, we can come before the Lord with boldness and come into the presence of our Creator and enjoy relationship with him. We do this through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so today, we drink this with celebration as we remember what he has done for us. Let's drink today. Please join me in this response. Creator God, show forth among us the presence of your life-giving Word and Holy Spirit to sanctify us and your whole church through this sacrament. Grant that all who share the communion of the body and the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ may be one in him and remain faithful in love and hope. And as the grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf and these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
Romans 8:15-25.
I don't understand myself at all, for I really want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do the very thing I hate. I know perfectly well what I'm doing is wrong, and my bad conscience shows that I agree that the law is good, but I can't help myself, because it is sin inside me that makes me do these evil things. I know I am rotten through and through, so as far as my old sinful nature is concerned, no matter which way I turn, I can't make myself do it. I want to, but I can't. When I want to do good, I don't. And when I try not to do wrong, I do it anyways. But if I'm doing what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing it. It is the sin within me doing it. It seems to be a fact of life that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another law at work within me that is in war with my mind. This law wins the fight and makes me a slave of the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am! Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin?
Thank God. The answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see how it is in my mind. I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin.
Well, it's summertime now, and I always like to have some fun in the summer with what we're doing in our services. And so this summer, since we're not getting together just yet, I thought maybe it'd be fun for us to have an opportunity to guess where Pastor Ryan is. And so during the summers, Sundays of the summer, we'll have a little contest. Where in the MD is Pastor Ryan? Now, today, I'm not anywhere too spectacular or exotic. I'm simply in the back 40 of our church property. There's a little bit of a trail system back here, and as you can see. And I'm just back here because it's a bit breezy today, and I feel like if I was out in the open, wouldn't be able to hear anything. So that's where I am. Today we're looking at Romans chapter 7, verses 15 to 25. We get the feeling like Paul has thrown in the towel a little bit here in this passage and is simply putting up his hands in despair, saying, well, sin is too difficult. The power of sin has too much hold over my physical body. So is there any point in trying to live for God? Can we not just rest in His grace and instead just go about our business? Certainly we have probably encountered areas of our lives where it has seemed like it might be a bit easier to do that sort of thing. Maybe you've been a person who has been on a diet and trying to lose weight, and you get to a point where you don't see a lot of progress. You see how difficult it is, and so you are tempted to simply throw up your hands in despair and say, that's it, I'm done, I'm not doing this anymore. Or you're a strong-willed child, and after a period of arguing about whether or not they're going to eat their peas at supper time, and the child defiantly not willing to budge in their position on this matter, you finally say, that's it, I'm not doing it, you win, it's not worth the effort, you're too strong, and I'm not going to be able to fight this any longer. Well, this is kind of the sense we have in this passage from Paul. And maybe we've heard it preached this way before, or maybe we've read it this way through this lens before, that Paul is just simply stating the power of sin and our inability to deal with it, so let's just rest in God's grace. But Paul, if we understand anything about Paul, Paul is anything but fatalistic. Paul is, in fact, super hopeful. Paul is somebody who has an understanding, and not only an understanding, but a pervasive sense of hope. He is relentlessly hopeful. And so it's really out of character. It would be completely out of character for Paul to be saying to his readers, the Roman church, well, don't worry about it, it's all good, just live in the grace of Jesus, and don't worry about how you live. This is not how Paul views life. So what's going on here? Well, taken in the greater context of the chapters in this section of Romans that this passage resides within, we see that Paul is trying to drive home an important point. There's an ongoing debate about the law's place, the place of the law of God, the Torah. Is it important or not important? Is it effective or ineffective? Is it to be adhered to, or is it to simply be cast aside and not worried about? There's different schools of thought going on amongst the people of God, and some people, in fact, think that they are slipping back into a works righteousness type of mindset, who think that they can earn their salvation, they can earn their way into heaven, they can earn their favor with God. And Paul is going into a long, drawn-out explanation in chapters really 5, 6, and 7, and on into 8 of Romans about why it is not a works-based righteousness, and why the law is inadequate, and all of those sorts of things, and how we need to be reliant upon the grace of God. It is only the work of Jesus on our behalf that allows us to have any standing with God whatsoever. Nothing we can do. There's no sense of works righteousness in Paul. However, Paul doesn't think that the law is necessarily a bad thing. Paul doesn't want us to throw up our hands and then live in the grace of the Lord, as I've already mentioned, but Paul wants us to understand what we're really up against. Paul wants to highlight the inadequacy of the law. But again, not to show that the law is worthless or bad, but just that it's inadequate. And that's one of the things we want to explore today. Paul is interested in this point. He is not necessarily speaking, first of all, in this passage from verses 15 to 25, just about himself when he speaks these iconic words, I know what I want to do, I love the law in my mind, but in my body, in my flesh, I do what the sin nature wants me to do. He's not just speaking about himself. Paul, in this passage, is using the I and me as a substitute for the people of God. And Paul believes that it's not just a personal problem, but a corporate problem, this whole wrestling with sin, wrestling between wanting to do what is good and not being able to, and constantly reverting to what is not good and what we don't want to do. The I of this text and the we of this text points to the whole people of God, Israel. Israel had ideals. They saw themselves as a nation under God, but as God's holy people, right? But they were repeatedly and consistently and pathologically unable to live under God's law. In fact, sometimes unwilling to do so. And so they find themselves in this predicament of wanting to live for God, but not willing or able to do so. And they find themselves in solidarity, not sometimes with Jesus, but instead with Adam, the old man, the old self. And they're unable to live up to the qualifications and the standards of the law itself. This draws us to think of a couple things. That this is not just a personal passage where Paul explains his own shortcomings, and maybe we should not use it as such either, but the overall state of God's people who had an understanding of how to live for him but did not, and in fact could not. And Paul lumps, as much as this is a corporate understanding and ideal that Paul is speaking of, Paul lumps himself in with them as well. As Paul lumps himself in with them is actually quite astounding, isn't it? Because Paul was a Pharisee, and he had lived his whole life believing that if you could keep the law perfectly, you would attain righteousness and help usher in the kingdom of God. In fact, Paul elsewhere writes about himself, not only was he a Pharisee, but he was probably a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was the top dog. He was someone who he believed actually lived according to the law of God. And so if anybody was worthy of righteousness, it was him. Well, Paul doesn't believe that the law is bad or it really actually inadequate at all. The law is good in Paul's mind and from his perspective. Remember, he was a Pharisee who loved the law, but here is what he's trying to highlight. Here's the inadequacy that he wants to bring to the forefront. The huge power of sin. Sin is the problem that rendered the law inadequate. And what the law does is show the pervasiveness and the power of sin. For even those who are fully devoted, even a nation that knows where it should stand, cannot completely live by the law and achieve salvation and standing with God. Now, let's not jump ahead here and think about all of the ways that we fail sometimes and we fall short, and think to ourselves that Paul is trying to say here, well, because sin is so powerful, then we can throw up our hands and say, well, sin made me do it, and so we're off the hook. That's not really what Paul is saying here. He's simply saying that the power of sin is so great that the law cannot deal with it, and we cannot deal with it. We're in a predicament. It makes fulfilling the law impossible, makes attaining our own salvation impossible. It makes working out our own righteousness impossible. Maybe You are a person who finds themselves in that situation, struggling with sin and trying to do good, but succumbing to sin over and over again. And you are tempted to throw up your hands and say, well, I give up. I'm just going to go on living like this and not worry about trying to live for God anymore. Paul would say to you, you're in good company. You are part of the people of God for whom God has done an amazing work. Don't give up. Don't throw your hands up in despair, but keep listening. Or maybe you're a person who looks at this and says to yourself, wow, if the law can't overcome the power of sin, what can? If the law can't overcome the dominion of sin and its hold on my life, what can? And you look around and you see the power of sin at work in your world. You see that there is disease and death that still resides under the power of sin. You see that there is war and conflict. You see that there is poverty and need. And you simply say to yourself, I live in a world that is dominated by the power of sin, so it seems. So I'm just going to give up. I'm going to throw my hands up and not worry about trying to resist the power of sin in my life any longer. Well, Paul would say to you, don't give up. Don't throw your hands up in despair. Keep reading. We're going to understand what has happened. So, verse 25 has the most hopeful words of this entire passage. And I'm thankful that these words exist, because otherwise we'd have to stop there and just simply recognize the power of sin and the inadequacy of the law. But Paul says in verse 25, thanks be to God through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And when we read those words, we can all exhale. We don't throw our hands up in surrender to sin's power when we hear this argument. We hear these words, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, a very simple, straightforward comment, and we can be filled with hope. In chapter 5, verse 20, Paul says this, while sin increased, while sin abounded, the grace of God, grace abounded, grace increased all the more. And this is one of the places where that saying comes to fruition and comes to climax. N.T. Wright translates chapter 5, verse 20 by saying, where sin abounded, grace superabounded. I love that saying. I love that understanding and that concept, that grace could superabound, that grace could be in a setting where it's over against sin in a way that is overwhelming. Just as sin overwhelms us, grace overwhelms sin. Just as we have no strength in and of ourselves to withstand the power of sin and the rule of sin in our lives, grace over sin has that same power. It is rendered powerless. And just as we are at the point of giving up in the face of the power of sin, Jesus comes onto the scene and utterly obliterates sin's hold on his creation through his death and resurrection. Yes, the grace of our Lord overcomes sin's power in a way the law could not, and frees his people from the clutches of sin and its hold and power, which is death. Hear these words, people of God, in the midst of your struggle. Thanks be to God, Paul says. And now you rest in his saving grace. Yes, as you struggle with the overarching power of sin, remember that grace has superabounded and supersedes that power in ways that we can't even begin to imagine. Life has taken hold, and new life has gripped us, and the power of sin has been rendered impotent. This is where we need to rest, in the saving grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When we think about the power of sin, there's not to say that there's no room for living according to God's desire for us. Just as Paul will not give up on the power or give up to the power of sin, he will also not throw in the towel for living according to God's expectations. And Paul will go into that a little later on in Romans, giving some hard advice, some hard and fast ways for living for God, which is good because we need those sorts of things. No, he won't throw in the towel for living according to God's expectations, even though grace superabounds. Paul believes that there is a response to grace that compels us to live for God, but the living for God is not what breaks sin's power. Only Jesus has done that. To go on living in sin, not responding to God's grace, is an exploitation of that grace, but living in legalistic pursuit of the ideal of the law is also an exercise in futility, according to Paul. Thanks be to God. Jesus alone has done what was required, and his superabundant grace swallows up the power of sin. It swallowed it up back then, and it swallows it up today, even though when we look around us, we wonder if the power of sin can be broken. Take courage. Don't throw your hands up to the inevitability of sin. Take heart, people of God. The power of sin has been dealt with. And if you are one of those people who's been tempted to throw up your hands in despair because of the power of sin over your life and over the world you live in, take heart and read verse 25. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I will. wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
As we end our service today, considering the superabundant grace of Jesus and its victory over the power of sin in our lives, receive this benediction as we go forth with hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.